Hello, I'm Dr. Mao. Welcome to the weekly Dial of Wellness COVID update. My associates and I will be giving you the latest development in the COVID-19 pandemic and some practical advice to help keep you and your family healthy. This is the second episode of the vaccine edition. But first, let's talk about where we are with COVID. 3 days ago, the U.S. logged over 17 million total COVID cases with over 300,000 deaths. On Wednesday, the country reported the highest number of new cases of the coronavirus and the most COVID-19 deaths since the pandemic began. On the same day, more than 3,600 Americans died from complications of the coronavirus. Here in Southern California, the situation's getting a bit dicey. The availability of intensive care unit beds throughout Southern California hit 0% Thursday. Once ICU beds are full, hospitals go into surge mode, which can accommodate 20% over usual capacity. Let's hope we won't surpass that. Meanwhile, around the world, reported COVID cases close to 75 million with 1.65 million dead. The CDC estimated that there have been approximately 8 times more people infected with COVID than actually reported, which brings the estimated total cases in the U.S. to 136 million, which would be more than a third of the total population. If that's the case, then the death rate is closer to 0.2%. To put that in perspective, the estimated death rate for the annual flu is 0.1%, according to the World Health Organization. This out-of-control surge comes on the heels of the Thanksgiving holiday, when many Americans gathered with family and friends against health officials' warnings. Authorities are concerned about a similar spike following the Christmas and New Year's holidays. What's in the news these last 2 weeks are vaccines, because Moderna's vaccine was just approved under FDA's emergency authorization and will be available as early as tomorrow. Moderna joins Pfizer in being the first two vaccines approved for the COVID-19 pandemic. Both Moderna's and the Pfizer vaccines have shown similar efficacy levels of close to 95%. The two vaccines are essentially the same, using the same new messenger RNA technology to command your cells to produce antibodies against the spike protein that is the signature of the coronavirus. Both require 2 shots. Moderna's vaccines administer 28 days apart, whereas Pfizer's is administered 21 days apart. However, there are differences between the two. First of all, each are wrapped in a different fatty package. This is the main reason for different handling and storage needs for each. For example, the Pfizer vaccine needs to be stored at about minus 75 degrees Celsius, about 50 degrees colder than any vaccines currently used in the U.S. The vaccines can be put into the refrigerator for only up to 5 days before it expires. In contrast, Moderna's vaccine can be kept at about minus 20 degrees Celsius, or about the temperature of a home freezer. Moderna's vaccine can also be kept in a refrigerator for 30 days before it expires. These differences suggest that Pfizer's vaccine may be used more for major institutions with special cold storage infrastructures, like hospitals and universities, while Moderna's may be more useful to smaller facilities like a local drugstore or a doctor's office. The most common adverse reactions to these vaccines have been injection site pain, flu-like symptoms such as tiredness, headache, body ache, swollen lymph nodes, and chills. According to the chief scientific advisor to Operation Warp Speed, about 10 to 15% of immunized study subjects will develop quite noticeable side effects. Due to limited supply, most of the early doses of both vaccines will go to frontline healthcare workers and residents of nursing homes first. It may be March or April at the earliest when they will be more widely available for the general public. There are a number of other vaccine candidates in the pipeline that will get approved in the next few months. Most notably, Oxford AstraZeneca's vaccine is probably the next in line. It's based on current flu vaccine method, which takes a weakened coronavirus from chimpanzee and grown in egg whites. The overall effective rate is about 70%, not as high as the Pfizer and Moderna ones, but better than the flu vaccine, which has about 50% effective rate. Side effects are similar to the flu vaccines. Again, at earliest, the Oxford vaccine will be available in late spring, pending FDA approval. Even among healthcare workers who will be the first in line to receive both vaccines before the general public, there have been reservations about getting the vaccine due to a lack of long-term safety data. In addition, there have been some reported allergic reactions to the Pfizer vaccine. So people who have autoimmune disease or severe allergies should discuss with their doctors about the potential side effects and whether the vaccines are right for them. For the rest of the population, it's important that you also have a conversation with your healthcare provider about which vaccine may be more appropriate for you or perhaps not at all due to your unique condition. And for the general public, if you decide to go forward with getting the vaccines but are concerned about reactions, discuss with your practitioners of acupuncture and Chinese medicine, as treatments like acupuncture and specific herbal protocols can reduce or even prevent potential allergic or flu-like reactions. And if you're counting on the vaccines to protect you from contracting the coronavirus, you'll have to wait. Estimates put availability for you in the summer and at earliest late spring. That means you still need to work on keeping your immune system at optimum performance and wear your mask in public and respect yours and other people's private space to reduce and prevent risk of disease transmission. I hope you found today's episode to be informative and useful. Until the next COVID update, take care of your loved ones by taking good care of yourself.